Good morning and welcome. Thank you for joining us this morning for our live streaming worship service. This service will also be available by 12 o'clock noon on our website, Facebook, or YouTube. Only your worship staff is present in the sanctuary this morning. Reese Smith is worship leader. Heidi and Kent Kenyon are our music worship leaders. I'm Vance Polly, and I'll be delivering the message. The bulletin for this morning is on the website and in the email many of you received on Friday. The bulletin is an aid to worship. It is not necessary for full participation in the service. At two occasions in the service, you may text us. You are invited to text questions for reflections on the message. You may send prayer requests during the ministry of prayer. The phone number in front of me is to be used to text. While we are unable to be together physically, technologically, we're still allowed to gather for worship in real time. Friends, may we greet one another in spirit. May the peace of Christ be with you and also with you. Amen.
God, in Christ, you call our name.
And then receive us as our own.
not through some merit, right, or claim,
but by your gracious love alone.
Great God, in Christ you set us free.
Your life to live, your joy to share.
Give us your Spirit's liberty
to turn from guilt and dull despair,
and offer all that faith can do,
while love is making all things new.
May the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we are in a time of the unknown. Many of your children, though we have faith, are afraid. And we look to you, God, in whom we have faith and confidence. In times past when we have been afraid, you have been with us. Even when we feel alone, we know in our hearts that you are there, comforting us, holding us in your care. Lord, this day and in the days to come, help us to feel your presence, to feel your love, and to be filled with your Spirit. We pray this in the name of your Son and our beloved Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. As we enter into this time of worship, it's important that we do so honestly, with open hearts. And in order to do that, it's important that we look into the mirror at who we really are. Humans, capable and culpable of sin. This is the time when we can join our voices as one, confessing our sin and our need for forgiveness. Eternal God, in whom I live and move and have my being, your face is hidden from me by my sins, and I forget your mercy in the blindness of my heart. Cleanse me from all my offenses, and deliver me from proud thoughts and vain desires. With lowliness and meekness, may I draw near to you, confessing my faults, confiding in your grace, and finding in you my refuge and strength. brothers and sisters, the news is so very good. Though we stumble and fall, though we make mistakes, the God we are here today to worship is a loving God, full of grace, whose mercy is from everlasting to everlasting. In Christ, we are forgiven. Amen. Alleluia.
That I've shaken and stirred.
Scripture lessons this morning have been chosen intentionally to offer us reassurance, confidence, comfort. Perhaps one of the most familiar within the Scriptures, and particularly amongst the Psalms, is the 100th Psalm. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord is God. It is he that made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. from 1 John, speaking about the very nature of community, the way in which we are bound with one another. Beloved, let us love one another, because love is from God. Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, for God is love. God's love was revealed among us in this way. God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love. Not that we loved God, but that God loved us and sent his Son to be an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Beloved, since God loved us so much, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is perfected in us. So, we have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love, and those who abide in love abide in God, and God abides in them. Love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us bow together in prayer. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts together be acceptable in thy sight, our Lord and Savior. Amen. There's a phrase we're using a lot these days, and that is social distancing. The need to remain roughly 6 feet apart and not gather in groups. I heard an observation earlier in the week, and I think it really is fitting. Rather than calling it social distancing, it really is physical distancing. And this service itself is an example of physical distancing and yet community bound together. We are connected. We are brought together in a virtual world, but in real time. Together, we are worshiping, even though we're in our own space and not gathered here in the sanctuary. In that way, we become virtual community through our social networks. I want to share with you something that New York's governor shared with the people in a statement he made to the state, but of course was picked up nationally. His observation: people are in small apartments, they're in a house, they're worried, they're anxious. Just be mindful of that. Those three word sentences make all the difference. Call and tell someone, I miss you. I love you. I'm thinking about you. I wish I was there with you. I'm sorry you're going through this. I'm sorry we're going through this. In so many ways, we have opportunities to bridge physical isolation. We are fortunate. There are a multitude of ways in which we can be in touch with each other. Obviously, a telephone call, but a text, our online life. Too often, we complain the problem with our social networks online is they lack the physical. And yet, we have the opportunity now to reach out and to be in touch when we need to create physical distance. So I invite you, touch base with your friends, your neighbors, perhaps those whom you've not spoken to before who live in the neighborhood. These informal networks are vital, especially at this time. And there are opportunities for us to connect with each other. We've already received offers here at the church to coordinate contact with others who need an errand run. Maybe they can't get out for groceries. Maybe they need to run somebody to go to the pharmacy for them. In all ways, we are able to help each other safely. Do it within your informal networks. Let us know here at Sunrise, because we will be part of connecting one another. We already have a number of people who have volunteered. They just need to know the need. Across the generations, there have been discoveries of how to be community in challenging times. And the Bible shows us a way. If you go back into the Hebrew Scriptures, back to the Old Testament, there is a perfect example of a discovery that allowed the people of Israel to remain in community even when they were separated from their sacred holy space. If you're familiar with the Babylonian exile, at one time Babylon came into Jerusalem, sacked the city, destroyed Solomon's temple, the Ark of the Covenant vanished, and the leadership was dragged into captivity in Babylon. And there they sat. And there they wondered. And everything they loved and considered sacred completely been destroyed. There was this deep longing to sing the praises of God, but how could that be done in this distant land? If you're not at Mount Zion, how could you worship God? And it was in Babylon that the people of Israel discovered you may still worship God in their homes. That's where the Passover celebration really took root, because it had to. And it sustained the people of Israel. It sustained the Jewish people across the centuries. It is a witness of the ways in which, even when we cannot physically be together, God makes a way for us to be spiritually bound. As I mentioned, Psalm 100 really tugs at the heart, because it lifts our spirits and it reminds us of the praise we offer God, but in addition, it reminds us of the care that God provides. That image of the shepherd, of God as our shepherd, is a very practical image, because sheep are tremendously dependent on the shepherd. In fact, they are lost without the care of the shepherd. So every time you hear the image, "The Lord is my shepherd," it's an acknowledgement of how dependent we are on God, how much God is present, and how deeply God cares. You see, the good shepherd knows each one of the sheep by name. That image Jesus used, the one lost sheep and the shepherd going searching for that sheep. Again and again, we are reminded that God is the shepherd in our lives, and that we are known, we are loved, and we are cared for. In 1 John, we are reminded of the very nature of community. We are invited to live into God's love, because God loved us first. And it's in God's love that we love one another. It is important to remember that those letters were written to communities that were struggling to care for each other as fully as they could. And it is a reminder, it's an inspiration, to show God's love by sharing that love with one another. You and I know there are very practical ways in which we can share the love. We can be in touch with each other. Those who are able can help by running errands. We can make sure that those who are facing hardship and need know that they're not alone and can feel the love and support of one another. We are still community, even if physically separated. I'd like to close with an image again that the New York governor, Andrew Cuomo, offered about remarkable opportunities that are presented to us right now. It's surprising that even in challenging times, something special can happen in relationships. He noted, as he spoke from the heart, that one of his daughters was in quarantine, and she was alone for 2 weeks. And here's what he said to the people of his state. To tell you the truth, I had some of my best conversations with her that I'd ever had. We talked about things in depth. Not that we didn't have time to talk about it in the past, or didn't have the courage or strength to talk about it in the past. Feelings I had about mistakes I had made along the way, that I wanted to express my regret and talk through them with her. Opportunities, even in the midst of uncertainty. We have perhaps more time to reach out with a phone call, to talk from the heart to a loved one, or ask to step back from the routines of daily life. It can be a burden, or it can be an opportunity. There is time, and there is opportunity to share with each other from the heart. Amen.
It's time for our ministry of prayer. During this time, if you have individuals for whom you would like to pray, please feel free to text those names to 843-437-4239. Let us pray. Loving God, we look to you this day. We ask that you be with all who suffer, for those who are ill. We ask that you provide the medicine that only you can give. For those who suffer anxiety or depression, we ask that you let them know that you are there surrounding them. There are those in our world who continue to suffer from poverty, those who live in nations that are fighting wars. We ask that you be with all of those people, letting them know of your love and of our love. God, this morning as we sit physically separate, though spiritually together, we ask that you fill our spirits with your spirit. We ask that you remind us this day and every day that you did love us first, and that you remain a constant. Lord, we give you thanks for all of the things that you have done for us, and we ask that you remind us of the opportunities where we can show our love for you and our brothers and sisters. We pray this and all things in the name of your Son and our Savior.
We lift to you especially Jean Campbell, Karen, Larry and Linda and Gary Hawkins, Linda and Holly, Devin McDavid Jones, Lord, hear these names that we lift to you spoken, as well as the names of those we lift from the silence of our hearts. May they know the depth of your love and your care and your comfort.
Amen. We are indeed richly blessed. This is a time during our service when we give back, where we help support those in need with our offerings. And though the plate will not be passed physically today, please go to oursunrise.org where you can securely donate online. Or for members of the congregation, please see the email that went out earlier this week, and you may mail a check as well. Let us continue to worship God with our gifts, our tithes, and our offerings.
I
us pray. Loving God, please accept these gifts as tokens of our lives. Please take them to places we may never go, to people we may never meet. Use them to serve those in need. Use them and let the people who receive them know that you love them and that we love them. We pray this in the name of our Savior, who taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come,
thy will be done,
on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Please.
All right. Question number one for Vance. You mentioned that loving others can be a struggle and that we should continue loving others in that struggle as God first loved us. Is the Holy Spirit the sustaining force necessary to do this? If it is the Holy Spirit, how do we come to have the Holy Spirit in our own lives? And if it's not the Holy Spirit, what is the influence God provides to continue showing his love in the times when it is so difficult to do so?
Thank you. Absolutely excellent question, and there are several parts to it. The first is the acknowledgement that it can and frequently is a challenge for us to love everyone. And it's that call to love each other is really a struggle. In 1 John, we are reminded that the love emanates, it originates with God. 10th verse. In this is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Opening up that statement, I like to think of the word atoning. If you hear it another way, the at one, atonement is that at oneness with God. And so it's God bridging the gap, the chasm that we've created. It's God's love that can then radiate through us. So the recognition that it can be a struggle to love each and every person, particularly those that will rub you the wrong way, the ones that cause you angst and frustration. One of the easiest things to do, or the most helpful, is try to look into the eyes of the person you struggle with and recognize that God has created all of us in God's image. It is in the image of God. And once you begin to recognize, are you actually approaching Christ at that moment? Then you realize the invitation is to think again, take a deep breath, and find a way to express love. The second part of the question has to do with how do we live that? How do we experience it? The Holy Spirit is the gift given to the community. And it is true, we are not physically together at this moment, but the Holy Spirit animates the love of God. It animates the actions of the community. And so we're invited to tap into the deep love of God that is present in the Holy Spirit. We feel it when we're together, but we also feel it even when we're apart. It is the Holy Spirit that gives us the energy, the vision, the inspiration to share God's love. Thank you.
All right, another one. This is a tough one, Vance.
Okay.
I think it is. How do we put our faith first over our fears?
The question is, what is faith? And at the heart of faith is trust. It's trusting God. And when there are fearful times, it calls for us to risk even more in trust. I like to think of it in this terms, and that is, who is ultimately trustworthy in our lives? Because we know as human beings, we do fail each other in action and in word and in indifference. But God never fails us. God is ultimately trustworthy. And that has been a message that has been shared across the generations. Again and again, what God desires for us most is to recognize that relationship that God wants with us, built on the deepest form of trust. And as we live into God's trustworthiness, it will give us the strength and the confidence to face our greatest fears. The fears do not go away. Remember that refrain we hear again and again? You hear it through the Christmas season. Do not be afraid. Why? Because God is present. God is near. God understands, and God feels with us.
All right. I think we have time for one more. That's okay with you.
Yes.
How do we talk to our children about what's going on?
They can feel the fear, the uncertainty, the anxieties. To tell them that they're not true is to cause them greater concern. We've already heard how we can address our own fears and anxiety. It's the trustworthiness of God. So to be honest with our children, to say, I'm scared too, but, however, God will not leave us alone. We're together. It's the reassurance that we are in this together. And together, we'll move through all of our concerns, all of the uncertainty, all of the fears. That's the most that we can do and to reassure. But if I can say one thing, please, please don't try to minimize the fears and the concerns that the children feel. They've picked up on it. They're real. Giving voice to them is fine. And then taking it with confidence and the reassurance, it'll make you feel better as well. Thank you. And now, friends, as we leave this time of worship together, may God go behind you to encourage you, beside you to befriend you, above you to watch over you, beneath you to lift you up, within you to give you the gifts of faith, hope, and love, and always, always before you to show you the way.